Hello and welcome to Tiger Report.
I'm Leonard Moore.
And my name is Elena Williams. Today, as we have an awesome show for you guys. We will be highlighting the annual Breast Cancer Awareness Walk, and we'll also be talking about some of the midterm candidates and about JSU head coach football's getting released. The American Cancer Society hosts its annual Strides Against Breast Cancer during or at the state capitol. Leonard Moore has more.
We're here at the annual Making Strides Against Breast Cancer annual walk here at the state capitol, where many have come to show their love and support for their loved ones who have battled or struggled with breast cancer.
11-year cancer survivor Tamara McGriggs is one that has participated in the walk for several years. McGriggs is now in remission and is inspired to continue to give her support.
Yes, and you know, I have family members that struggled with it in the past. So when it came to my turn, it became dear. Then I said, okay, I need to get up and do something about it.
Griggs is inspired to walk, even if she doesn't make it to the finish line.
I'm going to start out, even if I get weak and don't finish.
The walk is to raise awareness, fund research, support services, and early detection. Many pray that with every stride, a life is saved. Participants want to encourage others to get out and do something.
Anybody out there that's a survivor, know someone, or just want to inspire others, I encourage you to reach out and do so, because you never know when it's your turn. And it even strikes young people. I had many young people that came along with me that did not make it. They're not here with me today, but they was on the team at the chemo with me.
President Trump say that he's considering an executive order to end birthright citizenship that grants U.S. citizenship to anyone born in the U.S., even if their parents are here illegally. But many experts say that the president doesn't have the power to do that. CNN's Pamela Brown reports.
As President Trump heads to Pittsburgh, facing criticism on his inability to unite the country following a week of violence, he's now working hard to change the conversation.
We're the only country in the world where a person comes in, has a baby, and the baby is essentially a citizen of the United States for 85 years with all of those benefits. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. And it has to end.
The president proposing to change the Constitution, one he pledged to uphold.
Preserve, protect, and defend
the Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
By ending birthright citizenship with an executive order.
It was always told to me that you needed a constitutional amendment.
Right. Guess 14th what? Amendment.
You don't.
Except you do, according to constitutional scholars. Why? The 14th Amendment states all persons born or naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof are citizens of the United States and of the state wherein they reside. If the president does sign an executive order, it is likely to be immediately challenged in court. Some in Trump's own party already saying trying to change the Constitution is a bad idea.
You cannot end birthright citizenship with an executive order.
Constitutional reality aside, the political bottom line is Trump is appealing to his base by changing the topic to one of his signature issues, immigration. The administration also announcing it would deploy more troops to the southern border, even though a large group of migrants are weeks away from arriving.
I called up the military. This caravan is not, they're wasting their time. They are not coming
into the
country.
What's the military going to?
Trump is sending 5,200 active duty troops to join the 2,092 National Guard troops already on the U.S.-Mexico border. Altogether, that's more than the total number of troops serving in Iraq. But a week before the midterm elections, Trump argues the move isn't political.
When you looked at that bridge loaded up with people, that's called an invasion of our country. This has nothing to do with elections.
We will be back with more Tiger Report after the break.
WJSU 88.5 FM is a leading provider of cool jazz programming, news, and information to a diverse audience as a service of Jackson State University. Visit us on the web at wjsu.org.
Intense.
Aggressive.
Powerful.
Warriors.
Resilient.
Physical.
Determined.
Champion.
Passionate.
Team unity.
Knowledgeable.
Mental toughness.
go-getters.
I come from a family of educators, and they all graduated and received their degrees here at Jackson State University. Jackson State has given me all the tools that I need to succeed in life. Even after the class hours, my teachers continue to mentor and motivate me. Jackson State University has taught me to remain humble and go back within my community and make a change. I am Roosevelt Hawkins, senior in the College of Liberal Arts here at Jackson State University.
Recently, Metro Jackson Community Prevention Coalition held Bowling Night Out, keeping drugs out of the valley, out of the alley rather, one pen at a time.
Indigenous in a while, I don't know how it's supposed to feel.
All I know, I don't feel happy.
Tonight, we're excited to have our annual Bowling Night Out. We've been bowling night out with our students, peers, and our community since 2015. So Bowling Night Out is one of our diversional activities where we engage students in alcohol-free activities. In catering to our young people, it's very important to have these type of events to engage them socially and to encourage them to interact with each other without the use of alcohol and drugs.
We're gonna see the students having fun. And also we have the DUI driving under the influence glasses where the students will get a chance to bowl and bowl with the glasses on. And these glasses make them seem like they are intoxicated.
Well, you know, we've come out to support Metro Jackson Chamber Coalition, you know, it gives us a chance to interact with the students and have a positive influence on them, a positive role model. We like to come out and joke around, play with them, see a positive side of law enforcement.
I think that they should have more things like this, you know, to get the community out, get the kids out of the street, and, you know, have fun with the kids and, you know, let them know that they're not alone, that if you need help, you know, we have help here for you.
In an effort to increase voter participation on election night, SGA created a new event for JSU. Reporter Sianna Hope Reeves has more.
It is 1 week away until the 2018 midterm elections, and students are showing up to determine which Mississippi candidate is best fit for a seat in Congress and in local offices. Hosted by Jackson State University Student Government Association, students and community representatives gathered in JSU's Student Center Ballroom A to meet candidates vying for political titles and to push the students to vote.
So one of the things the Student Government Association is doing is we hosted several voter registration drives throughout this fall semester, and we're keeping the students informed on who's actually on the ballot, how are they representing us, what do they have planned for us, and just keeping them like abreast on what's going on. So that's the main focus.
Although not many of the candidates invited were in attendance, those present still discuss their vision and their action plan if elected in Congress.
Our vision, not just for our campaign, but also for this state, is one people, one focus, one Mississippi. And I'm asking every voter to remember that this is a partnership. If we are to build the Mississippi of tomorrow, it has to be one that's both inviting and inclusive, and it has to be one that's best positioned for success in the 21st century.
One highly anticipated politician students expected to see was Democratic candidate Mike Espy, but he was a no-show. However, his campaign team, along with students, still attended in support.
Mike's biggest thing is wanting to get things done when he gets there. So he's going to have a lot of things in policy that he proposes as far as addressing child care, health care, education funding, and he's really focused on addressing the brain drain in this state.
Make sure you come out and vote right here inside the Student Center Community Lounge, second floor, Tuesday, November 6th from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. Reporting from Tiger Report, I am Sienna Hope Reeves.
Dr. Lalita Gray, associate professor in the political science department at JSU, discusses the importance of the midterm elections and voting.
These midterm elections, this 2018 election, they are very important. A lot of times the midterms, it's like a referendum on the president or the party that is in power. So you look at what you are seeing. You listen to the news report, read the news report. Look at the different actions that have been taking place. Look at a particular party stating that they ran on wanting to get rid of Obamacare. And now that we're having these 2018 elections and people are needing health care, now they're saying, oh, we're all for keeping pre-existing conditions. But that's not what they said prior to. Listen to what the people are doing and go out and cast your vote. Make sure you go out and cast your vote and vote your conscience based on what you are seeing. You can listen to the news, read the papers, and actually see what is going on in your communities and make a very informed decision when you are casting your vote. It is very precious and it's very time. We are in some times that we definitely need everyone as possible in this electorate that can vote to go and vote. As I have stated to you guys, we have three equal branches of government. You have your executive branch, your judicial branch, and you have your legislative branch. But these are, it's not one is more powerful than the other. They have different duties. So Congress is not more powerful than the executive branch, and they're not more powerful than the judicial branch. They're co-equal branches of government. So what I tell you guys is you don't see a Congress that are refusing to use the checks and balances that are allowed to them in the Constitution. Congress itself, Article 2, created the executive branch. So as I stated to you before, they didn't create a branch that was more powerful than them. So it was not created that the executive branch would be all powerful and not have to be exposed to the checks and the balances. So Congress can, as I like to state to you guys, the term that you all like to use, they can put the executive branch in check if they choose to do so. So what I am finding difficult to actually believe that you have a Congress that is allowing a president to do actions that have been unprecedented in our modern presidency history in modern times. So Congress can act. The Constitution allows them to act.
Voting is extremely important because it is a way for your voice to be heard. We'll be back with more Tiger Report after this break.
Texas State has prepared me academically, spiritually, financially. I was already mature, but they taught me how to be mature in a professional manner.
The quality education that I received at Jackson State University really set the foundation to pursue God's PhD.
I came on my first visit. I love the atmosphere. The culture has so much energy. There's always something going on. Jackson State, to me, it's just a home away from home.
The Mississippi Jazz Foundation presents A Night of Musical Artistry featuring national recording artist Eric Roberson and Mississippi's own saxophonist Mike Burton. This year's event will be hosted by actor-comedian Palmer Williams. Don't miss this special night of jazz Friday, December 7th at Dueling Hall in Jackson. Advance tickets are $40 and can be purchased online at Ticketmaster.com. Tickets can also be purchased at the Thalia Mara Hall box office or call the Mississippi Jazz Foundation at 601-594-2314.
Welcome back. After 2.5 years at Jackson State, Tony Hughes is out as the Tigers' head football coach. Hughes was fired following JSU's 41-7 loss to Southern U Saturday night. Rob J. has the story.
Tony Hughes led his football team onto the field for the last time Saturday night. Following the Tigers' 41-7 loss to Southern University, Hughes was relieved of his coaching duties at JSU with three games left in the season. In his 2.5 years at Jackson State, Coach Hughes won 9 games and lost 20, including Saturday night's blowout loss to Southern, which all but sealed his fate.
Well, winning gives you confidence, and you believe that you can win any game that you're in. In the past, since I've been here, we've lost a lot of close games that, you know, were very, very emotionally straining to our football team and to our football program. A lot of it has to do with maturity and growth of your players and your football team. And so when you have as many young players as we have and as many young players as we play, sometimes they make a lot of mistakes, and we made crucial mistakes at critical times of the game that cost us football games over the last 2 years.
Jackson State Athletic Director Ashley Robinson released a statement saying, "Our goal is to find a new coach who will build on our great tradition and grow our football players." Robinson also announced that defensive coordinator John Hendrick will serve as interim head coach for the remaining 3 games. I'm Rob J. for JSU-TV.
After falling short in the quarterfinals last season, Jackson State men's basketball team plans to go further this year.
The enthusiasm, harmony, and ambition for the new season was present in the Jackson State men's basketball team practice Wednesday evening.
What everybody wants to see is a fast-paced team. We're looking to get the ball up and down the floor.
The shot, Benz. The shot, get it out.
Come on, Jake.
You should play a group of guys that's real intense, play with a lot of passion. We love to share the basketball, play with each other. The chemistry is great. A couple guys that's pretty much veterans of the team. You got Dontellis Ross, Chris Howe, Benji Wallace, and John Trail Walker, who more so of our guard-oriented team, and looking at, you know, distribute the basketball and score the majority of our points for us.
Once we get set in a set, then we'll probably go with our four-out, one-in motion. Defensively, we'll be just like we've been the last 5 years. It'll be tough, half-court, man-to-man team.
Finishing their previous season in 6th place, they are ready to go all the way, defeating anyone in their way.
Biggest competition in our conference, you got Grambling State University, you got Texas Southern and Prairie View. Those three teams right there, they got a lot of guys coming back, a lot of talent. They play really, really hard. They're well coached.
13 days away from the first game, we have a closed scrimmage on Friday against Southern Miss. Our first game, like I say, is November 6th against Louisiana Monroe, a team that we lost to over at their place last year. And they're returning the game this year. So just excitement of a new season. Just want to invite everyone out and so that they can cheer these guys on during the season.
Basketball season for the Tigers will kick off November 7th, playing against the University of Louisiana Monroe at 7 p.m. in the AAC. Our refs always have some interesting perspectives. Here's At the Whistle.
Blow the whistle. You know they can't play on my court, can't hang with the big dogs, stay on the porch. Blow the whistle. Blow the whistle. Blow the whistle. Blow the whistle.
Hello again and welcome to At The Whistle. Glad to have you all back with us. My name is Clement Gibson. This is Darius Barron and Kambui Bomani. Martavian Thompson is not here with us, but we will represent him well, starting with the NFL. Yeah. What are your thoughts on the top teams and the teams who aren't necessarily getting it done thus far?
Well, first eight weeks of the NFL season have passed, and obviously the cream of the crop is this Los Angeles Rams. A lot of people expect them to be very successful heading into this year, due to the additions that they had on the defensive side from Ndamukong Suh, Aqib Talib, and Marcus Peters. But their offense is taking the next step. Brandon Cooks has been incorporated into the system. He's a deep threat down the field. Cooper Kupp over the middle in the slot. We got Robert Woods as well. But the MVP candidate in Todd Gurley, he was the offensive player of the year last year, and right now through 8 weeks, he's got 15 touchdowns. And they have a huge matchup with the Saints coming up. If they win it, it could cement their legacy as one of the top teams in the league. Disappointing teams, however, the Oakland Raiders, John Gruden was expected to bring a resurgence to this football team. But so far, he's traded the top players and seems as if he's taking the tanking approach so the team can be more successful in the future.
Ready for Vegas.
Okay. Well, so like you said, Todd Gurley is a huge part of the offense for the LA Rams and a reason for their success. Now, the offense in the NBA has been kind of the defense is terrible. Offense is good. The defense was bad.
It's terrible. Anytime you get almost every team in the league to score well over 100 points, it just shows that there is no defense being played.
Right.
And, you know, unfortunately, now we're seeing an offense-driven league. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, anyone can probably name, on one hand, count the defensive superstars. Mm-hmm. You know, you got Jimmy Butler, Kawhi Leonard, Rudy Gobert.
Yeah. Maybe Joel Embiid.
AD.
I mean, come on now.
But that's about it, the five.
That's it, you know? And I feel like it's mainly because everyone wants to shoot threes and get back on defense and absolutely play no defense.
Right.
And the prime example for that would be superstars like James Harden, Stephen Curry,
right.
Kyrie Irving.
Yeah.
You know, and people will argue me up and down saying that Steph and Kyrie plays defense.
When they want to, yeah.
They play good team defense.
Anytime you can say when they want to.
That's a problem.
That's an issue.
Now we have the issue. What's the solution?
Man, bring back the defensive culture, man. You, like, in the league, you can't even breathe on your opponent without getting a foul. So that's why people like Isaiah Thomas is able to drive and score 30 a game because you can't touch
him. He's not doing it anymore.
You know, back in the old era, you know, it was believed if you go to the paint, you're going to get jacked up, period.
Yeah.
And that's just the way it is. Bring that physical brand of defense back. We need it.
Let's bring something else back next year. And that's the L.A. Dodgers. You know, they said the third time is the charm. There's three of us here. Yeah. The Dodgers are coming back for the third. I know 4-1, and it wasn't good. The Red Sox, yeah, they you know, they're all right. But the Dodgers are coming back for a three-peat, but this time they're leaving with the championship. And I don't care if y'all agree or not.
Cubbies are coming, brother.
On that note, we are out of here. Signing off, this is Clement Gibson, Kambui Bomani, and Darius Barron. If you would like to hear more via podcast or the YouTube channel, you can visit www.thejsuflash.com. Thank you again. Blow the whistle.
And if you guys could forgive us, so we made a mistake. The basketball game will actually take place November 6th rather than the 7th. And we'll be right back with more Tiger Report after this break.
The birth of legends are storied in this conference. We must never forget our rich history. We now turn our gaze to the future. The new legends will emerge. New heroes to arise. The Southwestern Athletic Conference. Be our history.
Intense.
Aggressive.
Powerful.
Warriors.
Resilient.
Physical.
Determined.
Champion.
Passionate.
Team unity.
Knowledgeable.
Mental toughness.
Go-getters.
People refer to record opening weekend, they're usually talking about a movie, but not always. David Daniel has that and more in Hollywood Minute.
One more big score, we got enough money to leave. What do you think?
Talk about a big score. Red Dead Redemption 2 made more than $725 million in global retail sales in its first 3 days. That's the biggest opening weekend ever, not just for video games, but in entertainment overall. By comparison, Avengers Infinity War set a big screen opening weekend record this year with nearly $100 million less. BBC.com has polled more than 200 movie critics from 43 countries asking for the best foreign language film ever. The winner? Akira Kurosawa's Seven Samurai, about the title warriors defending a poor village against attacking bandits. The 1954 classic came out ahead of films by other legendary directors such as Ingmar Bergman, Federico Fellini, and Francois Truffaut. Two movies from the House of Mouse are set to take top honors at the Hollywood Film Awards this weekend. Black Panther will receive the show's namesake prize, the Hollywood Film Award, while Incredibles 2 takes the Hollywood Animation Award. The ceremony, billed as the first award show of the season, takes place Sunday. In Hollywood, I'm David Daniel.
You know, Leonard, I don't think that we can really encourage people enough to go and vote this November 6th. And, you know, whenever you're considering whether or not you're going to vote, just think about how it has an effect on not only your local community, but the world as a whole. So with that being said, we want to thank you guys for tuning in to Tiger Reports. We hope you enjoyed the show, and we'll see you next time.